We're now being joined by Paul Ejime, former war correspondent and international affairs analyst. Welcome to the program, Paul Ejime. Good afternoon. Good to have you on the program.
Thank you very much.
Well,
thank you very much, my brother Abati.
Yes, thank you very much. First, CHOGM conference in 4 years because of COVID-19. It couldn't hold 2 years ago. Now we have had this summit in Kigali, Rwanda. A number of issues about the choice of the location. One, President Paul Kagame is considered a dictator. But we're told, now that summit has been taken to Kigali, because Paul Kagame is seen as a sweet dictator, a friend of the West, a benevolent dictator by Western standards. And there were many groups saying Kigali, Rwanda was a bad choice. And two, showcasing Rwanda and saying that, Paul Kagame will take over as chairman of the summit in the next 2 years is also in bad taste, given his record with regard to freedom, human rights abuses, and all of that. Let's start with that before we now talk about the Rwanda asylum project, which is part of the problem. Over to you.
Thank you. Well, I can see you're beginning from home, Charity. But, say whatever you may about Paul Kagame. He has brought some, value to leadership in Rwanda. Remember, this is a country that is coming from the ashes of 1994 genocide. And he's been able to turn things around. Rwanda recording, is considered one of the fastest growing economies in the world. And if you are in Rwanda, you will want to, you feel that there is a life of a country that knows where it is going, a country that when they talk about gender, that is a country where women populate parliament, and women are not afraid to assert their position. Every other African country, even Western countries, talk about the need for gender mainstreaming, but it is happening in real life in Rwanda. Those are the good things that you can talk about it. And he's somebody that also stood up to a foreign power, France. France was complicit in the genocide of 1994, but have been denying it. But Paul Kagame stood his ground, and recently, France came around to acknowledge that there was something they didn't do right. And I think there are only a few countries that can do that. It is Kagame that pulled Rwanda out of, he used to be French, English. But he took the bold step of joining the Commonwealth in 2009. And now other French-speaking countries are joining, Gabon and Togo, like your correspondent said. So, of course, Portuguese, Mozambique is also there. And Rwanda, under Kagame, is also showing example in supporting other African countries. It has sent troops to Mozambique recently to help fight jihadists. When AU is, dilly-dallying and didn't know what to do. So, of course, that cannot completely wipe out the fact that there are issues about human rights. But where is it that you don't have human rights issues? Is it in the West? Is it in America? Or is it in Britain, the head of the Commonwealth? So I think if you were to, on a balance, on a scale of, good or bad, perhaps the good that Kagame has done will probably cancel out whatever wrong he has done. And perhaps he has done so because there are reports about his, the way he treats opposition and all that. But let's face it, something is happening that could never have happened, perhaps without a Kagame on the throne. So if he's being criticized, you should take it along what he has brought to Rwanda. that ought to have, with the kind of leadership that we find at Africa, perhaps that would have been the end of Rwanda if we didn't have a Kagame, perhaps. That is still a matter of conjecture, but there is a fact. There are statistics and there are, you know, things to show, concrete evidence of what can happen when you have a proactive leadership, when you have a leadership with a vision, when you have a leadership that is committed. And along the line, there is no doubt that you can step on toes, and he has. And then you have to do that perhaps to also get a country going. You must stand for something, otherwise you fall for everything.
Paul, you know what you've just done is to push the strongman theory of leadership, popular in the 80s, but now, you know, 80s and 90s are now being pushed and justified in certain quarters. But I wanted you also to comment on the Rwandan asylum program. Rwanda hoping to gain £120 million per annum from the British. The British themselves are divided over this. Prime Minister Boris Johnson is busy telling the Prince of Wales, Prince Charles, to have an open mind. The Prince of Wales is saying privately that this Rwandan asylum program is appalling. And Priti Patel, on the other hand, saying, look, the European Court of Justice on Human Rights cannot dictate to British courts, hence there is the legislation before the House of Commons. What do you think of all of this? Is it all about money or more about human rights?
So I think there is more to it than money. Money could be part of it. Another thing is also that Britain finds itself, after Brexit, is now looking for more friends with a Prime Minister Boris Johnson that is also losing ground, just like French President Macron, his friend. They're all losing ground in terms of they're domestically. And what happens is that they tend to look out to see how they can force the attention elsewhere. But the fact is that Britain has been facing a problem with immigration. And then they are now looking for a way out. And then Paul Kagame felt, if you ask them, they will, Paul Kagame and his government officials will tell you, listen, we have come to help. We have seen people who are suffering and, you know, under situations that will not compare with what they will get in Rwanda if they were to come there. But also not take out the fact that if you gave somebody $130 million or $150 million or £130 million, that is not small money. But you see democracy in action. The courts have now weighed in. The prince has weighed in. Normally, the monarchy, the royal family, they are not known to come out, you know, to join or criticize government. But Prince Charles has gone to do so. And you wonder, they went to Rwanda to begin to try to talk about the same differences. Fortunately for them, it didn't feature on the agenda of CHOGM, the Commonwealth. But if you ask me, the point is, let the law take its course. If the civil society, if all those that are likely to be involved find it that it is not a good decision, I think it will be killed. But if, again, there is some good in it, there are those who will actually want to go to Rwanda. But there are few. There are few who will want to go to Rwanda. Many will rather want to go to Britain as a place of asylum. But this is where we have. In Africa, we have many of them. The point, again, is one would have wished that it were just African asylum seekers or immigrants that have been handled. But here, you probably get people from Ukraine, you get people from Europe. They will not, for any reason, knowing the racist world we live in, inequality, they will say, well, how come it hasn't come to that? For European blue-eyed and blue blood to be taken to an African country, that is an abomination. But they don't have a choice. So now it is for the court to determine whether Boris Johnson, when he gets on anything, he wants to get through with it. Just that he got to Brexit, and now the British people are thinking, I wish they had thought it all through. He will say he will go ahead with it, but let's see what happens. He's losing his a number of his MPs and ministers. And so he's not, he's a damaged goods. He's somebody, through elections, yes. So he's no longer the strong prime minister that. Yes, so it's not no longer the strong prime minister that he used to be. So, but he will, the human rights groups and everybody, they are on this matter. And they will go at it and even take it to the highest level of British court. And if they don't find anything good, if they think that that is inhuman or that he has is appalling, like the prince of Wales said, well, they may still have to go back on it. But Kagame, I don't think he has committed any crime by saying, okay, I have a place where you can bring these people, and then you pay me some amount. And Britain, trying to get out of a problem, decided to found a place to go.
I need to manage time, and I still want to ask you one or two more questions. Now, the theme for this year's summit is delivering a common future, connecting, innovating, transforming. That's the theme of the CHOGM that just ended in Kigali. What do you think are the big takeaways from that summit this year?
Well, I think your reporter mentioned that about malaria and the so-called NTDs, tropical neglected diseases. These are diseases that are killing more people than all the wars, even the Ukrainian war or any war that you think about. But they've been neglected. They've not been talked about. And there hasn't been any vaccine. COVID came 2 years ago. And everybody, the whole world was agog, trying to develop something. So much so that Africa has also been shortchanged. It became, you heard about hoarding of COVID, vaccine nationalism and all that. So one of it, if it can be maximized, to stop under five children in Nigeria from dying unnecessarily, to stop pregnant women from dying from malaria, I think that could be one thing. The summit also talked about ramping up support for the vaccine for COVID. But by the way, after Ukraine war, COVID has suddenly disappeared, to tell you how the world functions. That there are those who determine, the agenda setters are no longer talking about COVID. It's now who supports or who does not support Ukraine against Russia. So those are the things. They talked about youth unemployment. They talked about technology, how you can use that to access legal service, and a whole lot of other things. And by the way, in the next 2 years, an African, the Secretary General position will also come to Africa. He went there in 1989. We had to accompany our own dear Chief Emeka Anyaoku to campaign under General Babangida's government, and he became the first African Commonwealth Secretary General from 1989 to 2000. So in 2 years' time, it will be the turn of Africa to also produce another Secretary General. Perhaps that it also will be an incentive, an inspiration, a linchpin to be able to draw the Commonwealth attention to move to Africa once again. Commonwealth, it has its criticisms, but I remember that they were the foreign ministers. They had a committee that worked against apartheid. When Mrs. Thatcher and others, America, were all against sanctions, the Commonwealth decided to go for it until apartheid was removed. They have the games, they have the scholarship, and those are the benefits that are there. But they could do more. No matter the situation, I think everything needs an improvement. So perhaps Commonwealth with Canada, Australia, India, and then you also have territories that are less than 100,000 people amongst them. That is the beauty. That is the tapestry. You have the cultural diversity you have in the Commonwealth, which is something to behold. That after how many years, they are still there. There is work to be done. It's still work in progress. You can never solve all the problems of the world, but you have to start from somewhere. And I think the organization is doing, if they can cite to you that if countries are now joining them from Francophone, it says perhaps they have that to tell you that there's something good they are doing. That is why members are, they are now 56 from 54. I think I have done much of the advocacy I can do for the Commonwealth.
Well, Paul, just before we go, Baroness Patricia Scotland now has two additional years as the head of the Commonwealth Secretariat. Kamena Johnson-Smith from Jamaica was also interested, but, you know, they voted, the heads of government voted to keep Patricia Scotland for two more years. And Johnson-Smith says, well, it's not our time yet. God does not say it is our time. What more do you think Patricia Scotland needs to do in terms of the agenda of reform at the Commonwealth, in terms of the modernization of the Commonwealth, which has been a major issue in the last 6 years?
My brother, Ruben, I've learned to respect women when they are in leadership, positions of leadership. Here was a woman that Boris Johnson campaigned against. Britain was supporting a Jamaican,
yes,
who had to concede. So it is a case of she knows what is there. I think COVID truncated her rule. That is why she's now getting a second two more years. But I think she understands the politics. She knows what to do to get developing countries around her. She's originally from Dominican, but raised in Britain. So she probably understands what it is to be deprived. She knows about hunger. She knows about suffering and inequality. I think this will, she was accused of corruption and every other thing, but she has weathered that, and I think she can contribute her quota. That is what it is. The world is a stage. She cannot solve all the problems of 56 member countries. She can only contribute and then leave the stage, and others will take over. I think she understands the game. She understands leadership. She understands the Commonwealth. And she understands as a woman, as a mother. And then, inequality, segregation, and all that. And I think she will play her part and then leave the stage.
Well, thank you very much, Paul Ejime, for joining us on This Day Live, this Sunday talk show today.